to see everyone here tonight in the service. Let's begin. Stand to sing. At the cross, alas, and did my Savior bleed, and did my Sovereign die? Alas, and did my Savior bleed, and did my Sovereign die? Would he devote that sacred head for sinners such as I? At the cross, my heart rolled away. I received my sight, and now I am happy all the day. Great singing. Please be seated.
Well, we'd like to welcome you to the evening services here, the midweek service here at Eastland Baptist Church. And you may say, well, where is the others? They are in the Victory Hall, and the Adventures of Marriage is going on. I think they have somewhere around between 50 and 60 involved in that program, and it's going to go on for the rest of the month, and we ask if you will, and we have our prayer time, if you remember them in your prayers. There's, as I said, there's a lot of issues in their lives. In fact, there's one person that we had one of our young ladies, and she's engaged and going to get married. And I asked her, she gave a report tonight that she's going to the mission field. She said, no, I want to go to this thing. I want to make sure I get married right, you know. So they're excited about that. So just pray for them, if you will. And this coming Sunday, I'm sure everyone in this room knows what's going to go on. It is Father's Day, all right? We want to honor our fathers. And I've said this before last Sunday, you know, beg, borrow, get a father, bring him with you, and let's honor him this coming Sunday, and that's June the 19th. And again, I want you to circle the date. We're going to keep you in remembrance of this, that our missions conference is next month, July the 20th through the 24th, and we're calling it Whatever It Takes. I don't know if any of you have ever heard that song. I think I've listened to the song every day for the past month. And sometimes I just break down. It's just so powerful. Whatever it takes to draw me closer to you, Lord, that's what I'm willing to do. And I just encourage you. That could be your prayer. You say, well, what if the Lord calls me away? Wouldn't that be great? And I'll just tell you a story that first time I heard that song was we had a mission team come in for our services. And they sang that song, and I went back to the director, who was a leader. I said, you got to sing that song again. He said, no, we can't. We're not ready to sing that song again. That's our prayer. Whatever it takes, Lord, that's what I'm willing to do. That's a hard prayer, especially when you listen to the song and the words of it. So that's going to be our theme. That's going to be our prayer. Lord, what do you want me to do, and where do you want me to go? what can I do to serve you in this place for the Lord Jesus Christ? And I just challenge you with that. And then also the last Sunday of the month is we have the teens, and they're going to have their barbecue dinner, and it's their fundraiser for their trip to go to Pensacola for camp. And I just, I'm amazed at how many are going. There's 45 total that are going, and it's going to be a great time. And I encourage you again to pray for them. If you can help them financially to get over there, that would be great. All right, do I have our ushers ready to go? We have a couple men to help us with the ushers, if we can. Yeah, there you go. Get these two good-looking guys here. One older, one younger, all right? And it's through the tithes and offerings of God's people that the work is done. So let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father, we are grateful and thankful for the opportunity of being here again tonight, and we ask now your blessings upon this offering and upon all that's going to be done with the gifts that we give back to you. And we want you to multiply it like you did the fishes of old, and much can be accomplished and souls will come to know you. We do pray for the group now that are meeting in the Victory Hall, the Adventures in Marriage, and each couple represents a life, their lives together, difficulties, problems, victories. We pray your special blessing upon them and also those that are leading and directing it. We pray for what's going to be done here, and that whatever is taught will be just what we need for this hour. We love you, and again, we thank you for the way you're provided and for the way you've watched over us. We ask now your blessings upon all that is done in this place. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you for the offering.
Be still, my soul, the Lord is on thy side. Let's stand once again, sing an old, old gospel song called He Included Me. Anybody familiar with that? I don't think we've sung it in a long time, but if you'll help us, we'll sing it together. I am so happy in Christ today. I am so happy in Christ today. Singing along my way. Yes, I'm so happy to know and say Jesus included me too. Jesus included me. Yes, He included me. When the Lord said, whosoever, He included me. How many of you recognize that song now? Oh, a few more. Let's sing the line. Gladly I read. Gladly I read. Whosoever may come to the fountain of life today. I always say Jesus included me too. Jesus included me. Yes, He whosoever, he included me. Jesus included me. Yes, he included me. When the Lord, whosoever, he included me. Freely come drink words the soul to thrill. Oh, with what joy they my heart do fill. For when he said, whosoever will, Jesus included me too. Singing, thank you. Be seated.
When Brother Rockwell was speaking Sunday night, he talked about how that we have less young people surrendering for full-time service. I think even than during my lifetime and growing up in my teenage years and also my early years pastoring. And I thought to myself, why is this happening? Why? What is it that causes us not to get that burden, our young people especially, to get that burden? And the Bible says, as was written in Lamentations, says, my eyes affect my heart. And the question comes, what do they see or what do we see that affect our heart? And I think of a few mission trips that I've taken that when you step on the grounds and you see what these people do, the Christians especially, with so little, and how they so much love the Lord. One, speaking in leadership and or getting people in the church, and I said, why don't you have a friend day? Invite all your friends to come and have dinner on the grounds. A guy came up to me and he said, if I did that, I wouldn't be able to eat for a week. Another one said, if I did that, I'd have to go to the Buddhist temple. When it got through, they came back to me individually, and the guy said, you know what? I'm willing to sacrifice a week's meals to get somebody to Christ. And the other guy said, I'll go to the Buddhist temple, but he'll come to church with me. You see, they saw something that we don't see. And I, when you see these missionaries show their slides, they're just not slides. They're not just pictures. They're people's lives that have been changed, that love the Lord, that want to serve the Lord. And so when I looked and I heard that again, my mind went over, and I don't know how many months ago, maybe a year or so ago, I put the five top reasons why people hesitate to surrender to the mission field. Why don't we go? What is, or even a missions trip? There's fear of safety, leaving family behind. Worst case scenario, you worry. Feelings of inadequacy. Questions of doubt, cultural adjustments. I mean, you get in some places, you think, how am I going to get out of this? You know, and you wonder what's going to happen next. But it's so amazing to see what God does in these situations. There's so many stories that you could tell how God used you to touch the hearts of others. There's this one story, and I was in Ethiopia, the communists, I got there a day late, didn't know what I was going to do. They scattered all over the city. They divided into 10 areas, and the guy said, would you meet with my leaders in my area? I said, sure, what do you want me to speak on? He said, would you speak on steadfastness? I said, you want me speak on steadfastness? You guys are running for your life all the time. He said, would you do it? And so I did. And as I started to speak, they started weeping and crying. I thought, oh no, what did I say? What's this guy saying? Because you're doing it through an interpreter. What, they took me back to the hotel to leave the next day. He picked me up and I said, what happened? Why were they crying? He said, every one of those men came that night to quit. And they decided to stand for Jesus Christ. I had no idea. And you never know what God can do through you if you say, whatever it takes, Lord, I'm willing to do. What is it that you're willing to do? I'm not going to read all that, but you can look it over again, as some of you have done. Let me turn to the other side. I'm going to pull out just a couple of these here. The Supreme Court decision on abortion is to be announced soon, probably within a few days. We need to really be praying that the men will have the courage to stand. And then, the national issues that we face, revival, division, and the spiritual and national issues, abortion, social issues, police issues, and of course our pastors and our churches in our country today. And then for Eastland, the services that are being held in Ormond, if you want to go, like on Thursday, there's people going over there. If you let us know, we'll get you hooked up and go over there. And we would like to have somebody that you say, I'm not very much of a singer or a song leader. If you could just get in front of somebody and you can sing a little bit, you can go tomorrow night. You know, they'll be thrilled to have you. You say, well, I don't know if I'm that good. Just let the Lord use you, take you where you are and be used. See me afterwards. Get under conviction between now and after in the service, okay? The second thing is positions in the Sunday school. We're seeing things happening and growing and such as this, so we need people in different areas of Sunday school. We'll pray again, ask the Lord what you should do about that. And then Vicky's mother is going to have biopsies on Monday. Please pray for her. Vicky Bohannon, as you know, passed away, and her funeral will be this coming Friday at noon here in the auditorium. And the different ministries were involved. Debbie Price has asked us to remember a family member, Susie Riddle, as she is going to have hip replacement surgery today, and that it will go well and have a complete recovery. And she lives in Titusville. I've had a couple that were given to me. Janice Krill and Angela Zimmerman are battling cancer. Remember them in prayer. Micah Norton, who is 30 years old, has three children and a wife. He's going to have two heart valves replaced. He knows the Lord is his Savior. And it's Chris Norton's cousin. And Chris Norton's cousin, and then the Heather Carmichael, this is one of throat problems. That's Christian Atkins' mother. Remember her, if you will, in prayer. That was given to him. And I'd like to challenge you, if you will, to call your prayer request in. We can get them in the bulletin. We're putting them up on a board now so we can look at them quicker and faster and get them into the prayer bulletin. But if you will, let us know before we print them, then everyone will have a copy of that. All right, let's bow our heads in prayer and we'll pray for these requests. Father, we think of the words Jeremiah when he said, my heart, my eyes affect my heart. And Father, I pray that as we go into this mission conference for the month of July, that what we see, what we hear through videos and presentations and listening to missionaries and mixing with them and talking to them, that our heart will be moved and we'll see what they see. And we pray that not only is it just to raise money for them and that though they need it, but that our hearts will be moved to doing those things that you want us to do as a church. And Father, we do pray for these requests, especially we think of the Supreme Court decision that is soon to come down. And we pray that our leaders and our country will stand where you stand and give the courage to our leaders to take a stand also. And then we think of the spiritual national issues that we're facing. Lord, you know we need revival. And we know revival begins with us. And I pray that you'll move our hearts. And then we think of the request here at the church. We think of Ormond Beach and how much time and effort has gone into it, not only in the services, but in the work that's been done on the facilities. And we pray that through all the efforts that have been done, that you'll best bless them, and that many will come to know Christ, that a church will be built that will bring honor and glory to you. We think of the Sunday school and the different positions from the nursery all the way up to the adults and care group leaders and Sunday school teachers and those that would be just concerned for others and come and listen and help the teacher to build the class for you. We think of the other different ministries that we've been involved in, not only at Ormond Beach, the other churches that we've helped. And I just pray that you continue to bless them also. Pray for Vicki Young's mother also. She goes through this biopsy. And we do pray for Debbie Price and Susie that she goes through this hip replacement surgery that she's gone through, that it's gone well, and pray for a complete recovery. And I just pray now that, again, that you see us as people that have this desire burning with our hearts to do those things that you want us to do. And help this to be our prayer, Lord, whatever it takes to draw us closer to you. Thank you again for all you've done for us, your goodness and your love and your provisions and your blessings upon this church. In Jesus' name, amen.
Would you stand with me once again and sing that great old hymn, I Am Thine, O Lord. I am thine, O Lord, I have heard thy voice and it told thy love to me. But I long to rise in the arms of faith and be closer to be a sanctuary, pure and holy, tried and true. Lord, prepare me to
Good to see you again. Take your Bibles and turn to the Old Testament, 1 Samuel chapter 8. I have a handful of verses I want to read there to you tonight. I hope you're doing well. I hope you're trying to live for the Lord Jesus. Sometimes our flesh catches us off guard and we don't behave the way we should. I mean, except for me and Steve, we always get it right, right, brother? Amen. Hope you're trying to be encouraged, meant to people. We go through seasons in our lives where we're very in tune with God. One day we wake up and we're not so in tune with God. But no matter how we're feeling, we need to always be obedient, try to be in the house of God, be around the right people, be under the word of God, try to honor God. And again, like I always say, try to act like we belong to him in this dark world. These folk need to see people trying to lift up the name of Christ in their life as well as with their lips. Even today, I appreciate Pam. Pam texted me. Her daughter and son-in-law, I was up in Tennessee this time last year when we had their wedding. And she has a grandbaby now. And her daughter has a new job. I think he's a French teacher, right? And she said, she just told me this stuff and just reminded me to give them a text and say, well, I'm really happy for them, you know. And just little things like that, you know, her reminding me sending them a text. Just text someone and tell them you're thinking about them and maybe you stopped and prayed for them, you know. Just that just helps. I mean, there's been so many times in my life where I've been really, really down and I get a card or I get a letter or I get a text or something. It happened to you and just sort of lift your spirits. To hear something good or someone's thinking about you. You know, 1 Samuel chapter 8 and verse 1. And we see here, being in family month, and I appreciate all the teenagers that are on the property and the children. And I appreciate what Brother Newby's doing with the marriage class tonight. And I pray everybody's strength. And I pray you learn something from the Word of God. I pray you're encouraged. But 9 verses here. And the context here is that Israel, it's probably been 500 years since they've come out of slavery in Egypt. 500 years, Moses brought them out. They've come into the land, and the way God led them was through Judges, the book of Judges. And the most famous probably is Samson, there's Jephthah, there's different ones. And God would speak to them, and God would use them to deliver Israel from their enemies and give truth and knowledge and things like that. And so there's a transition happening here. Israel is going to go from being ruled by judges to a king, okay? And so is that a good thing? Is that a bad thing? Well, let's figure that out together, okay? And so their head is Samuel. He is the prophet in the nation. He is very close to God. God speaks to him. The Old Testament this time is being put together. They have the Pentateuch. They have the first 5 books, but the Bible, the Old Testament, is being developed, okay? History is happening. Things are happening. And in verse 1, and it came to pass when Samuel was old that he made his sons judges over Israel. They're still judges. Probably Samuel was probably technically, some would say, the last judge. Now, the name of his firstborn was Joel. The name of his second was Abiah. They were judges in Beersheba. And his sons walked not in his ways. They didn't act like dad. Dad was a very godly man, God-fearing man, very wise man. Listen to this, but turned aside after lucre, that's money, and took bribes and perverted judgment. Then all the elders of Israel gathered themselves together and came to Samuel unto Ramah, another city, and said unto him, behold, thou art old, and thy sons walk not in thy ways. Now make us a king to judge us like all the nations. But the thing displeased Samuel when they said, give us a king to judge us. And Samuel prayed unto the Lord. And the Lord said unto Samuel, hearken unto the voice of the people in all that they say unto thee. For they have not rejected thee, but they have rejected me, God said, that I should not reign over them, according to all the words which they have done since the day I brought them out of Egypt. Leadership is the very thing. Leadership, we're talking about the family, the home. Leadership in the home is a very important thing. everybody has some realm of authority, of leadership that God has put in their life. That is influence over other people's lives. Every school teacher has been ordained by God, given authority to influence people's lives. Every father, every mother, every pastor, every Sunday school teacher, we go on and on and on. I try to teach young people, you know, it'd be probably be wise to be obedient to authority, because you don't want to be authority one day, then all of a sudden want to be have all these followers, amen? It's amazing how they resist it until they get there. Then they want everybody to cooperate with them, you know? So here we see leadership in Israel during this time of the judges. I'm not going to go into it, but in chapter 2 through chapter 4 of 1 Samuel, if you want to read it when you go home, you see Eli, who is the high priest. He's the high priest. He is the priest of all the priests, been ordained by God, given spiritual leadership over the things in the tabernacle. They did not have the temple yet, to worship God, to bring sacrifices to God, to represent God to the people. I just thought of something. Who do we got to represent us to God now? We got Jesus, amen? We don't got to go no temple, because we are the temple, the Bible says. Almost make you lazy, doesn't it? Amen? But Eli, if you read those chapters 2, 3, and 4, you'll see that he had the same problem with his sons. As a matter of fact, the Bible said that people, the people that wanted to worship God, abhorred or hated going to the temple because their sons were there doing wicked things. That's bad. I don't want to go to church anymore because this is what's going on there. Heard that story before. Their names were Hophni and Phinehas. But we see the same thing happening with Samuel, the godly man's sons. It says here in verse 2, now the name of the firstborns were Joel, and the name of the second was Abiah. They were sons in judges in Beersheba. And his sons walked not in his ways, but turned aside after lucre. They did the work of God for money. The Bible, the New Testament, calls it hirelings. They don't care for the sheep. When something goes wrong with the sheep, they flee the sheep, the Bible says. The people of God who are in authority over the people that God has placed under them should care about the sheep, care about those that God has given them. We see also they took bribes. I'm so glad that kind of stuff doesn't happen in our city with our judicial system here. We have some law people here. We have some people in law enforcement. Now, you laughed. You didn't even flinch. You know, okay. You ain't seen none of that going on up there, amen? Well, yeah, I got some judges that just tell me how it is, Pastor Green. When you go to court, you better have your good lawyer, and they better have connections with the judges, or you're going to have problems. And the sad thing is, we probably still got the best system in the world, you know. But here's what they did. They did it for money's sake. They took bribes. And this is the worst thing. They perverted judgment. Man, the Lord Jesus, all through the scriptures, talks about fairness and equity to people. Man, God is not a respecter of persons. People think they can buy things, buy their way out of things here in this world. They will not buy themselves out when they stand for the creator of the universe. It doesn't matter if you're a Baptist preacher, it don't get you nothing with God. So this is such a horrible situation. You have the high priest. You have the prophet of Israel, the one that God speaks through. You have his sons who have a horrible testimony. I'm telling you, after the Word of God, the most powerful thing to draw people to Christ is your testimony and my testimony. I weary so much in my life that I tell you, I have to throw the church, I have to throw preachers under the rug so I can talk to people and differentiate Christ between. I wish that every preacher, every church had a great reputation of being close to God, but they don't. And people equate these things. And so It says in verse 3, they walk not in his ways. Remember a scripture that I preached 3 weeks ago, Psalms 18:30, where it said, as for God, his way is perfect. I pray that we would walk in God's ways, but these sons did not. They had no justice for the people unless you were going to pay for it, unless you had something. So we see in the priesthood, with the prophet, with the judges, there was failure of leadership. Now, what's going to happen here? These elders in verse 4, looky there, they're the heads. Here's leadership again, probably the heads of tribes, the heads of the people. It says in verse 4, then all the elders of Israel gathered themselves together and came to Samuel unto Ramah, where he was at. So again, you have the priest, you have the prophet's sons, you have the judges, you have the elders. Ain't nobody showing no good leadership. I sort of feel like that today sometimes. Y'all just staring at me, man. Well, why is the world... And I want to tell you the problem here. I'll tell you in just a minute. But these guys are going to use the disobedience of all these people in leadership as a pretense or as an excuse why they're not going to let God rule and reign in their lives. I've told you before, years ago when I was a younger man, in my 30s probably, I'm driving down 436. I remember where I was driving down 436, right there at the intersection of Loma, headed towards Altamont, and I'm listening to some talk radio guy, and he makes a statement, oh, what do you want? You want a theocracy? And I'm in my car screaming, yes, yes, yes! Who do you want to rule over you? Why would not anyone want to submit themselves to the authority of Jesus Christ? You're going to fall, and I'm going to fall under somebody's authority. Somebody's going to have the power. I was talking to someone the other day, I think it's in Corinthians, and in Romans chapter 13, it talks about how God has given authority to government, to be rulers, to be good rulers, to protect us, and to punish evildoers. And I think 1 Corinthians chapter 15, it says one day that God's going to call back all authority back to himself and put it under his feet. And all the authority that we've been given, whether little or a lot, we're going to be judged for the positions he's given us in our lives. That's a little bit of a fearful thing, that he's going to judge me for as being a father, as being a pastor, as being a Sunday school teacher, as being a football coach, as being an English teacher. Every time I had authority over people's lives, he's going to judge me how I use that authority. Did I do it to exalt myself? Did I do it to get gain for myself? And did I do it to lift up the name of Jesus Christ? Just a thought here. We all got it. I want you to understand and understand that. He said, we want a king to judge us like all the other nations. Now, I don't have time to get in tonight on Wednesday night. If you want to look at the nations around them, like Moab and Ammon and Edomites and the Philippians who are their enemies and all the others, if you looked at those cultures, the context would be a little more real to you. Those nations were a stinking mess. They were wicked people. They did things... They sacrificed their children. I won't even go into the wicked things that their false gods were horrible. And we want to be like them. I love when the leaders in our country sometimes, we want to have a system like Europe. I mean, which one? Like Greece, who went into bankruptcy? I mean, which country are you talking about? That's why everybody's fleeing to Greece and not to America. I don't get it. Why does mankind follow all else besides God? And again, I want you to see that the word used many times here is the word Lord, which means creator. And in this case right here, I believe it's just not a question I'm asking. It's a real question. Why do people want to follow everything else and everybody else and said the Creator and the Savior? I believe in many cases they're just deceived. I believe they're deceived just like Eve was deceived in the garden. Satan goes, hey, listen, God don't want you to have that tree because he knows. He knows the moment you take a bite of that, you'll be just like him. And you'll know the difference between good and evil. And he halfway told the truth. I think many, especially our young people, but it's still as adults, we're always going after things like we're going to miss out on something. You ever made those decisions in your life? Oh, I got to do this. I don't want to miss out on this. And you get there and you go, uh-oh, that was a horrible decision. Anybody like that? Maybe two or three of you. Got one in the back here, amen. Got David. Thank you, David, brother. All the rest of them were liars, David, okay? Yeah. It's the truth. God says, don't do this. Well, we're just like Eve. We're just like these people. We don't want to fall under the leadership of Almighty God. We might miss out on something in life. Same way we treat our children. It's amazing how they resist our authority and our wisdom to keep them from destructive things in their life. And I appreciate Samuel. In verse 6, it says it displeased Samuel. Many of you have heard this text many a time in your life. But I like what he did. Something I'm trying more and more in my life to do is that he prayed. He prayed. I remember you told me a story once about how you always prayed about decisions in your life. And one time you didn't, and it didn't go right. And you said, God taught me a lesson, man. I pray over those important decisions. Pray. 500 times in the scriptures it says, pray, pray, pray. It says, pray without ceasing. He was a wise old, he was old, but he was a wise old man. He seeks counsel from God. Listen, the answer that God gives him little surprises me. God says, Samuel, listen to the people. Give them what they want. I'm thinking, why would you do that, God? Well, let's look at the text here. He says in verse 7, he says, the Lord said unto Samuel, hearken or listen to the voice of the people and all that they say to thee. And again, in the marriage thing, I'm telling you, they're teaching tools of how a husband and a wife ought to listen to each other. They're giving them tools to do it. Now, I've been told in my life, listen to people. But you know what it is? You're listening to people. I mean, you're watching their mouth move and you're looking in their eyes, but you're just getting ready for when they stop, you're getting to say what you're going to say. You're really not absorbing what they're saying. You been there too? Okay, yeah. They're really trying to teach them how to hear how the other person. He says, listen to them. Listen to what they got to say. He says, and God sort of calms the spirit of Samuel, this godly man. And again, there's so many things to talk about here. Why does this godly man have these two jerks for sons? I got some answers, but I don't know if they're the right answers. I mean, you can be raised in the right place and still have a rebellious heart towards God. I can't believe, I don't know if he was busy and he didn't train up his boys to fear God and love God and serve God. I don't know. I don't know what went wrong here. Samuel was raised around wickedness. He was raised around carnal, fake religion and still followed God. I don't know what it is. I know this. It has to do with the heart, whatever it is. That's a fact. He says, just calm down. He said, they have not rejected thee, but they've rejected me. I watch as we're in family month, and I watch young people as they disobey their parents. They look at their father, they look at their mother, and they think they're disobeying their parents. They don't realize they're disobeying God. The commandment to obey your parents came from God. I love in the text when David sinned and killed Uriah the Hittite and committed adultery with his wife and he lied and things like that. He said, against thee only have I sinned, God. Because if there ain't no God, there ain't no sin. You got that right. I love talking to the atheist. Well, that's wrong. Who said it's wrong? Well, society says it's wrong. Oh, you guys are God instead of God. I get it. And when you're young, you don't think this stuff through. But it's insanity. God, what's happened in our society with our judges downtown, with the elders, or we'd call them county commissioners, and representatives. I want to tell you what, a little sideshow here. Yesterday, we interviewed a bunch of people running for school board. And it's sad, but the school board has become the biggest thing in politics now. They're running our kids. They're not teaching them academics. They're perverting their hearts and their minds. And I learned a lot talking to these four Christian people who are running for four of the seven seats. They're getting ready to vote for a superintendent. They've narrowed it down to two people here in Orange County. The number two requirement is that you have to go along with something. But it is. It's just social engineering. It's homosexuality, transgender in our schools. That has to be a strong, for you even to get to be a superintendent, be considered, that's got to be a strong point. Number two in being a superintendent. They taught us a $123 billion. You remember the trillions in the virus thing, you know what I mean? $123 billion was set aside to interject this philosophy, this godless philosophy, into every public school in America. They do things behind our backs. They take bribes. They have perverted judgments. That's what's going on. So it's just not the politicians. It's also school boards. It's things like this where they're doing things that parents don't even know. He said, they have rejected you. They've rejected me. He said that I should not reign over them. I'm old enough now that I have no problem Jesus reigning over my life, submitting to all of his authority because of the deep love that he has for me. You know, that's the way the marriage, we're in family month. That's the way marriage is supposed to be. A wife should have no problem submitting to the authority of her husband because it's his deep love for her, his protective care, his going out and trying to earn for the family and do for the family. He is not first. He's the head, but he's not first. They're first in his life. It's the same thing with God. He has power. He has authority, but he takes all that and he loves us. And he calls us his own. He calls us his children. I have no problem submitting to his authority. And that's the problem. In our city right here, everybody has rejected the rule of God over their lives. Can I get one amen there? It's true. God has nothing to do with the decision-making, most cases, what goes on in the city. And even in churches, he doesn't have a whole lot of say-so. It's a man who has the say-so. This is the core issue of this right here. God says it. It's not your problem, Samuel. They've rejected my reign over them. They've rejected my word and my law and made their own law. It's us resisting the wisdom and the rule of God. And we are so blind and we're so foolish. And people are telling us, no, go this way. This is a better way. You're going to miss something. This is better than God's way. Just like Satan did to Eve in the garden. Look at this. Look at the long-suffering of God. He says, according to all the works which they have done since the day that I brought them out of Egypt, even unto this day, wherewith they have forsaken me and served other gods, so do they also unto thee. That's why I said, since Moses to this time, it's been about 500 years. Don't tell me that God ain't long-suffering. Don't tell me that he don't put up with our nonsense. He is long-suffering, not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance and turn to his great love. And so, as a pastor, man, I see it every day. I do not have to write anything on my calendar, on my list, tomorrow morning. And I will be full of text and phone calls and people walking through my door with problems. I'm not kidding. I don't have to make a schedule anymore. That's how bad the world's gotten. All I have to sit there with an open Bible and wait. I'm like the Maytag guy waiting for the phone call. But they coming through the door, they're wearing me out. It's all because we have not submitted to the wisdom and the rule of God in our lives. And he's the only one that can fix us. The problem is when we get into our sin, sin don't want to let go of our lives. We can see it, that it's going to destroy us. We've seen the pain it's brought into our lives, and we'll go back to that same well. That's our sin nature. It's incredible. And I'm saying this is for everybody. This is for the church. This is for unbelievers because of our sin nature and not submitting to the authority of God in our lives. And you know what? Tomorrow morning, your preacher can wake up tomorrow and his sin nature can kick in and he can do the same thing he's preaching about. What are you talking about, Pastor? Didn't Paul say that? He said, I'm afraid when I preach to others that I might become a castaway, that I might commit the same sins that I preach to others not to do. I'm telling you, that's how every day the inward man has to be submitted to God. Since Egypt, 500 years, he said, they have served other gods. Now here, I'm not going to go out and serve Buddha. I'm not going to go become an atheist. But if I turn my back on God, I'll find something else to do. I think that's better. My old flesh, my old heart, someone will tempt me. I'll lie and go down the road and do it. Paul said, Demas, who used to work with Paul in getting the gospel out, he said, Demas hath forsaken me, loving this present world. We got a lot of brothers and sisters loving the world and not loving the things of God. This is good stuff. I should have saved this to Sunday morning. We would have had the whole big crowd here. We got to pull them out and get them involved over. Whatever. Yeah, here we go. You guys are fun. Today, people want to follow something other than God, even Christians. Even sometimes, people we think that are good Christians, they get a lot of things ahead of God. God's just sort of something we do on Sunday. God's just sort of something we do when we ain't got nothing else to do. Oh, I like this. This is good. But the Jesus said, the truth will set me and you free. I want to be free. And freeze with Jesus. Verse 9, he says, hearken to their voice. Listen, look at this. I'm going to close with this verse right here. Verse 9, he says, now therefore, that means a closing statement. Therefore, I've sort of laid the plate out. Here's what's going on, Samuel. It ain't about you, it's about me. He said, Samuel, they've been going on for 500 years, these people, looking for something other than me, the one that delivered them and saved them and lifted their name up in the earth. He says, now therefore hearken unto their voice, howbeit, yet protest solemnly. Just quietly. He says, no more fighting them no more. He's just going to go. And I've learned a little bit to do this sometimes myself. Well, and you know, so that's what you want to do. Wow. That's an incredible choice, young man. Wow. God bless you. And it goes on a little bit further. Protest solemnly unto them and show them the manner of king that shall reign over them. When I talk to folk, it's so simple. I open the Bible. It's just, you keep it simple. If you use a lot of words, people get really confused. Don't talk a lot. Just keep it simple. Well, here's the path. We read the scripture. Here's the path that God wants you to go. But you're saying you want to go that path. You want to go this path in your marriage instead of the way God wants you to go. You want to do this way, you know, concerning serving, whatever it is. And say, well, here's what, and I've lived long enough where I go, here's what's going to happen. And so Samuel tells them, here's what's going to happen. You're going to get a king. He's going to tax you. He's going to take your best men, your best women, your best horses. And they said, whoa, I think we'll take God. No, they didn't. We'd rather have a king. Don't get it. But you know, I've been there on smaller issues in my life. Here's God's way, Psalms 18:30, as for God, his way is perfect. But you know, if we had all our young people in here, they'd be sitting over there and go, oh, that's an old guy. He don't know what he's talking about. He don't know what fun is anymore. Is that what they say? It's what they say. Until I get them on the basketball court, Brother Larry. Then you know, I whipped two teenage boys, me and Jeff Young, yesterday. It's close, man. It's 21-20 at the Y. I walked over to the two mothers, watched them. I said, those are your boys? I said, they're very unkind old people because I'm about to have a heart attack. Them kids were running and shooting threes. I was wore out, but I wasn't going to lose to them. It was sweet, but no, it's just a tool to talk to them. One boy's name was Emmanuel, and there's another boy, and that's how I witnessed to people. Go play a little basketball with them. mess around with them and talk to them about the Lord Jesus. You can do that. There's stuff you do. I don't know how I got on that. He says, don't fight them on this. Just tell them the path they're going down. That's what I do with people that are Christians who want to walk away from God and be like Demas. That's why I tell sinners, now just think this through here. You're rejecting the perfect love of God in the person of Jesus Christ. You know, the Bible says in Philippians chapter 2, verse 10 and 11, that one day every knee will bow and every tongue will confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. But if you do it too late, you're going to pay for your sins. But if you do it now, you're forgiven of all your sins. Everybody who has ever lived will bow before Jesus and call him Master and call him the Christ, the Savior. Man, I'm glad I'm older because it's just so easier to see this stuff. And therein lies the problem, waking up tomorrow morning and giving God authority over my life and believing that his way is the perfect way. God bless you guys. Father, thank you so much for today. Here I am, 64, God, and this book seems so clear now. Only if I'd seen or understood the things I understand now. All the heartache in my life that I could avoid it. All the things, even good things, dear God, that I was chasing, and I should have been chasing you. And you would have probably given me those things anyway. Dear God, would we learn, those that are here, and maybe those who are watching a live stream, could we go against our sin nature and the lie of our heart that says, pursue everything else? Could we make you Lord of our lives? Could we make you the God of our lives, and trust you and believe that all the things that you'll place in our life will please us and bless us, dear God. I imagine there might be a few that might get it tonight, dear God, but I pray for all of us that we would not be like Demas after we've helped Paul and been in the work of God and then go pursue the things of the world. Help us all to remember that our flesh is just a decision away from taking over the reins of our lives again. Thank you. Bless everything that's going on, the property. Bless those marriages that are, those people that are working on their marriages, dear God, our teenagers, our children. I thank you for the people watching the little children in the nursery right now so we can sing songs and hear the word of God and fellowship. Bless their dear hearts for their service tonight. In Jesus' name, amen. God bless you, gang.
Amen. As we leave tonight, let's stand and sing that chorus. He lives, he lives. Christ Jesus lives today. He lives, he lives. With me and talks with me along life's narrow way. He lives, he lives. Salvation to it. God bless you. You are dismissed. We'll see you back Sunday.